For most reporters, the White House press briefing is a daily ritual, also a daily sparring match. Most everyone leaves feeling frustrated. My next guest offers a suggestion. Writing in the New Republic, the daily briefing has become a worthless chore for reporters, an embarrassing nuisance to administration staff, and a source of added friction between the two camps. It's time to do the humane, obvious thing and get rid of it altogether. Joining me is Reid Cherlin. He was President Obama's assistant press secretary from 2008 through March of 2011. He's now a freelance journalist. Why kill it?
Well, I just think it's a waste of time.
Oh, come on. This is where taxpayer dollars are put to work. There's some degree, it may be a circus at times, but there's some degree of daily accountability there.
Well, you know, I think when you really start looking at it, there really isn't that much of a degree of daily accountability. I would definitely agree that the White House needs to answer questions, should answer questions, and it does answer questions. But the way that it does it is hours before the briefing, throughout the day, starting when, you know, morning reporters on this network get up in the 5 o'clock hour and start emailing people, hey, what's your position on Egypt today? They know the answer. By the time it gets to the briefing, which is an old institution that predates the internet by decades, everyone kind of knows what the answer is.
I'll agree with that, and I will say, in full disclosure, that for this network and for the Associated Press, when I covered the White House, I did a little calculation yesterday. Uh-huh. I think I've attended nearly 3,000 White House press briefs. And it's torture,
yeah.
And there's a Stockholm syndrome and all of that. But nonetheless, there is some degree of discipline imposed on the White House. You're going to show up there every day, and reporters, you're going to show up there every day and spar away, but have something to talk about and take something to the American people.
Right.
If you eliminate that, then you're just White House tweets, White House blogs, and .gov. It's the White House propaganda machine.
Well, I don't think that's entirely true, because I think, again, we talk about the way that the briefing is supposed to be, and I think a lot of us think about it the way that we remember it, frankly, from the West Wing, from the show, not the way that it really...
It was never the way it was in the West Wing.
Right, but if you look at how it actually goes day to day, it has its moments. Basically, in the first couple minutes, the White House establishes its positions of the day. After that, there's no accountability happening.
I have a few moments here.
Okay. Like,
from the sublime to the ridiculous, the best and worst of Jay Carney.
The United States remains deeply concerned by the increasing violence across Egypt. We are committed to trying to prevent Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon.
And about the congressional picnic that has been postponed, what was behind it?
The president did not communicate with Jay-Z over this trip.
So we have Jay-Z and presidential picnics, but we also have Iran and Egypt. And things happen so fast and happen every day. If you didn't have this, what would we have in your world?
Well, I think you'd have the same thing you have now, which is if you watch, and I think Jay does quite a good job, actually, for what he's supposed to be doing. But if you watch, what he's doing is largely reading statements, particularly on foreign policy, out of the briefing book. Now, on foreign policy, that's important. Those statements are carefully crafted, and each word carries a lot of weight. But the fact is, they get emailed hours before that. They're going to be emailed all day. I just think in this day and age, information is kind of like water. It's just going to find its way downhill. However, and it's the way things are going now, it just gets out earlier, it gets out faster and more efficiently and better. And then I think what that does is it hollows out the briefing so that everyone kind of knows what's going on, and there's just a lot of rancor
in
there.
Well, maybe we should require the briefing to be more substantive then. Maybe Jay Carney should come prepared not to just read from the briefing book, but to take people inside of a process. Mike McCurry, a former White House press secretary, says the biggest mistake he ever made was allowing the camera to turn on in that briefing.
Well, and this is a point I think I tried to make in the piece in limited space, which is Mike told me the same thing. Once you turn the cameras on, and particularly you have the cameras facing backward, and they are shooting the correspondents all asking the same question, because they include that in their package for the nightly news. Here's me, the heroic reporter, challenging the press secretary on this, even though the other five other correspondents have just done it. It creates an air of theatricality that gets everyone's eyes rolling.
Well, there are daily briefings at the State Department. There are daily briefings at the Pentagon, or near daily briefings at these places, and they have a totally different tenor and tone.
Right.
Largely because the White House is such a center of politics, and the president is trying to set the agenda.
Right.
The president, you are trying to set the agenda. And what reporters are doing is pushing back and saying, wait a minute, you shouldn't set the agenda. We should set the agenda, or the news should set the agenda.
Sure. I guess I would just say, does the briefing ever really drive the agenda? The briefing is almost every day a reflection of kind of what the top news is, and that's totally fair. And you know, to a certain extent, there's value in that. But we all sort of know what the story of the day is. We have an hour set aside where everyone kind of fights about it, and really no new information comes out. And then at the end of that hour and a half, or hour and 15 minutes, everyone's kind of where they started. We can feel good about the fact that we have an open society where, in theory, the White House is being challenged. I just think that if we did some of these things, like turned off the cameras, had more of the gaggle type format where it's the reporters asking the press secretary tough questions, but it's off the camera, or off camera rather, that tends to be much more helpful.
How about more access to the President of the United States? You know, President Obama, your boss, did fewer news conferences and formal gatherings with the informed press corps, who right. follows him on a daily basis, than anybody since Ronald Reagan in his first term.
And I think he should do more. And, you know, I never asked
so
about it.
So we can do
it.
That? We can say his former press secretary is calling on Barack Obama to hold more news conferences?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
How many more?
Absolutely.
How about a daily news conference?
I would be for that.
And a daily briefing from the President of the United States?
Well, look, daily from the President of the United States, you might get into, you know, something, a concept that's tossed around a lot about watering down his forcefulness. But I think if you look at it, every time he speaks to an issue, he's giving the right, the definitive answer.
Well, so we'll come back to him for news and Q&A, and we'll see where it goes. Thanks very much, Reid.
Thank you.